Thank you, Deb. Good morning. Welcome to our worship this morning as we celebrate the baptism of Jesus in our theme today. And at our 11 a.m. service, we will share that gift of baptism with Aiden Cruz, sharing that sacrament from God's activity in our lives, reaching down with His grace among us. Wanted to share a reminder to those who are visitors, not yet members of the church, but interested in engaging and officially partnering with our congregation. Come and Grow With Us is a series of meetings that we have together with those interested in membership. Those meetings will be beginning soon, so if you're interested in participating in those, I invite you to speak with Pastor Ed today after church. Also, if any of you ordered poinsettias and have not taken them with you yet, I invite you to do so today. We've been watching over them. I know Brenda Hemgee's been doing a wonderful job taking care of them since Christmas, but we'd like to get those into good homes now, and as the weather is warming up today, it's supposed to get up into the 40s. It'll probably be above freezing about the time that we finish worship today. I invite you, if you haven't yet taken a poinsettia, to do so today. Find a good home for those. Invite you to keep in your prayers those hospitalized, including Norm DeHardy and Rose Nehens. And also we extend our sympathies and our condolences to the family of Richard Rathje. Dick died last Saturday, and services were yesterday morning here at the church. And with that, I invite all of you to stand as we begin our worship service with the order of thanksgiving for baptism. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light, and our salvation. Amen. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight.
In the waters of the flood, you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea, you led your people Israel, slaving into freedom. At the river, your sons baptized John, and the Holy Spirit. By water and your word, you claim us as daughters and sons, making us heirs to the promise and servants of all.
We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life. And above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your Spirit and renew our lives with your forgiveness, grace, and love. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Continue with our gathering song.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Holy God, creator of light, giver of goodness, your voice moves over the waters. Immerse us in your grace, transform us by your Spirit, that we may follow after your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Congregation may be seated. I invite the children to come up.
Good morning.
Did we catch you earlier? Okay. Got you already? Did we reach you, Brooke? We did? Did we reach you? Okay. All right. You know why we did that? Were you kind of wondering? Baptism. That's true. That's true. Baptizing everybody. Well, we weren't actually baptizing everybody, but we were remembering baptism. Today is about remembering and celebrating baptism and what God has done with the world through baptism, through that gift, when God sends the Holy Spirit into our lives to be with us. God reaches down from where God is at. God goes to where we are. We believe that God goes to where we are, not the other way. Not the other way. We don't climb ladders up to our Lord. Our Lord comes down to find us and to be beside us. And so we celebrated that today. We could do that every Sunday. What do you think? What do you think? Every Sunday? We could do it every Sunday. Now, we don't do it every Sunday because, well, we probably run out of tree branches and things. These get dried out after a little while. But what we can do is remember that gift every day. Because every day we're around water. We're around water that gets us clean. We're around water that cooks our food. We're around water that refreshes us when we drink it. Because we can't live without water, you know that. Yeah. We're around water that does dozens of different things every day that help give us life or that help make our lives better. Whether it's washing things or making things for us, we're around water all the time. Water that falls from the sky and makes things grow around us. Water is everywhere, and everywhere that we find water, we find life. We find life happening. When we're in the pool, yeah. When we're in the pool, that pool is giving us life. When we're in a lake, it's given us life, and it's giving other things that are in there life too. So it is always something that reminds us of life and celebrates life, and it's always something that can remind us of God's promise. You know, what we did today with water is something that we're invited to do every day. Every day we're invited to take a little bit of water and make the sign of the cross. And this is more sap than water, unfortunately. But take a little bit of water and make the sign of the cross and remember that you are marked and claimed by God forever because of that water of baptism. Can you pray with me? God, you chose to come among us in Jesus, your word made flesh, and you reveal yourself to us in the basic stuff of life so that we can continue to find you in abundance wherever we go. And we thank you. We thank you for that grace. We thank you for claiming us. We thank you for adopting us through that gift. Amen. Thanks for coming up. Worship continues with our readings.
The first reading is a reading from Genesis. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth, the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. While Apollos was in Corinth, Paul passed through the interior regions and came to Ephesus, where he found some disciples. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you became believers?" They replied, "No, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." Then he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" They answered, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was coming after him, that is, in Jesus." On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. Together, there were about 12 of them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I invite you to stand for our gospel acclamation. Holy Gospel according to St. Mark in the first chapter. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And he proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven saying, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Congregation may be seated. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death. So that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall most certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We read this promise from the sixth chapter of Romans at funerals on the occasion of death. We shared it yesterday as well at the service for Richard Rathje. We shared it at that time to make it known that by our baptisms we are joined to Christ's death and resurrection. It reminds us that whenever we gather around the font, we are also, in a sense, gathering around the cross. We are being joined to that mission. We are being joined to that journey. That in baptism, we begin a course. We begin on a course that leads us to that destination of Calvary. Because the waters join us to that outcome, to that sort of life that is only fully realized. Only fully realized when we are willing to die to sin, die to the ways of this world, die to the patterns of cruelty and hate. putting those things to rest so that God can give us his life in its place. It's one of the reasons why in the baptismal liturgy we ask people to denounce sin, denounce the devil and all of his empty promises, because we're turning from those things. It's what repentance means, to turn one's life and to move into, to step into a life that's fueled by mercy, forgiveness, justice, and hope. And that connection between those two moments in Jesus' life is something that stands out in a couple of ways in Mark's account of baptism. I wanted to make reference to this for a moment. It's an insert in your bulletin. A painting of the baptism of Christ, beautiful color. You can see in the reds that are at the top of it. It's like that light and that spirit is bursting through. But you may also notice that as Jesus ascends from the waters, his arms outstretched, a bit reminiscent of the dove. The dove that the Spirit resembles as it comes to rest on him. But also reminiscent of another moment. Reminiscent of another moment when he was raised up. Another moment when God powerfully spoke from the heavens for us to recognize and acknowledge his Son and what he was doing. That moment of crucifixion, when his arms were outstretched. So we see in this painting those two moments intersecting, intertwined together. And that image of God reaching out and pointing to Jesus in this direct way, is, while it's a spectacle, while God exalting and singling out and pouring his glory on Jesus, as he does in the moment of baptism, while it's the sort of spectacle that we long for when people talk, because sometimes people will say to me, I really wish that God would speak and act in the world today. And usually as we have conversation further from that statement, come to realize that God does very much speak and act in our world today. But what we're talking about is just something so clear, like this moment when that Spirit descended. But this sort of exalting doesn't happen a lot, even in the Scriptures. It would happen again at the Transfiguration. And it would happen again when Jesus was ultimately exalted in the cross. And another thing that this account has in common with Christ's death on the cross is a Greek word that shows up in this account. The Greek word schizo, which means to tear apart. Because in the account from Mark, it doesn't say that the heavens were opened. There's a word for opened, and that's not the word that they used. It doesn't say that the heavens were moved to the side. It says that the heavens were torn apart. And the Holy Spirit descended on Jesus. And that same word for tearing apart happens again at the crucifixion, where the curtain of the temple is torn in two. Torn from top to bottom. Torn from top to bottom. And in both of these situations, because usually if we hear of something being torn, the inevitable next step is that it be mended. But what we see at the baptism, with the tearing of the heavens, just as with the crucifixion, with that curtain, is that there are some things in this world that are meant to be torn. There are barriers that are meant to be removed. And baptism accomplishes this in our lives. At the death of Jesus, that barrier getting torn apart, that curtain of the temple, had served as a visible, almost like an impenetrable force field between God and the people. No one could pass through it except the appointed priest. So it was a tearing that symbolized access to God, a liberating of the Spirit and God's presence into the world. The tearing of the heavens here is a similarly dramatic image, and it likewise allows God's Spirit, God's kingdom, to be poured out, not only on Christ, but on all of humanity. The tearing of the heavens meant that God was no longer obscure, no longer far off. That kingdom and that reign was physically, spiritually descending into our daily routines. Epiphany, we enter this season of Epiphany now, a season of the church year that celebrates the light and life of Christ coming among us. And the readings are filled with transformative moments and appearances, miracles, new beginnings, calling of the disciples. But along with that image of the light being carried out, beginning from Bethlehem and Jerusalem and going out throughout communities in that region of the world, along with those things, maybe this season is also about tearing apart. I'm going to move so that you can see the image up there. Maybe it's also about tearing apart that which obscures or limits others from knowing God's love and truth. Because even though the heavens were torn at his baptism, for that rain to be near us, there is still tearing to be done. There are still ways in which the light and the Spirit is thought to be out of reach. There are still so many invisible barriers that we have to one another, that we have to knowing God, that we have to knowing its truth. Some barriers that we put up for ourselves, some barriers that we have felt put up by other people around us. In baptism, we're washed clean of the claim of sin and death, but not so that we can think of ourselves as perfect. And oftentimes, there is still a barrier to God's light and God's life and God's truth from those who think of it as a requirement that it be perfect. To quote Richard Rohr, speaking about life in Christ, it's not about being privately correct. It's about being fully connected. It's not about fulfilling requirements. It's about a trusting relationship. And it's not about what we do. It is about what God does. It is about God's activity. It is about God's activity where even the Son could do nothing but submit and receive God and life itself, eventually destabilize the boundaries of our small selves. Our small selves, as we limit one another, as we limit ourselves, as we limit our thinking, so that we can awaken inside of a larger self, a larger reality. Because God's grace and forgiveness is about welcoming us and receiving us and tearing down whatever impedes that. whatever impedes that, tearing down the idea that people have that they may not be fit enough, that they may not be worthy enough to stand here and call on his name, because that idea still exists. There are labels that people grow accustomed to carrying on them. Maybe those labels were applied by a poor decision that they made once upon a time, a long time ago. These waters say that those labels do not matter. That all of these titles, that all of these ways that we identify ourselves, all of that falls away. And we are people who belong to and are claimed by the Spirit. So for any who see themselves as not qualified, not good enough to contribute, not good enough to participate in studying God's Word with others, the Spirit of the Lord is given to tear that nagging doubt away from us. And whatever else in this world would serve as a barrier, whatever else in this world would keep us from knowing the reign of God, being buried with Christ through our baptism tears that open and allows that Spirit to enter in. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to stand as we continue our worship.
The whole church, let us confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human.
For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Confident that God, our light and our salvation, hears us when we pray, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. Our intercessory response is, have mercy, O God. For the church and the ministry of the baptized, tear open the heavens, Lord, and let your Spirit be upon us. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For the earth and all living things, for favorable weather, especially in this cold winter, remembering all your plants and all your creatures in this time, let us pray. For the leaders of national and local governments, agencies and organizations, for areas of the world suffering from war, that you would bless all your people with the gift of peace and justice. Let us pray. For the sick and the suffering, the imprisoned and the hungry, the cold, the lonely, the grieving, especially for those we name in our hearts, that Christ, our great physician, will soothe and console all in need. Let us pray. For our local community and for this congregation, that in all our joys and all our sorrows, we remember that we are your beloved children. Let us pray. In thanksgiving for our ancestors in the faith, both distant and near, who have taught us to believe the good news of Christ, let us pray. Merciful God, you hear our prayers even before we speak them. Receive them for the sake of the one through whom you have revealed your goodness, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. We share the gift of peace. Offering, I'm going to invite Nate Balcom forward.
All right, good morning. Well, we have a faith formation director, so I must be up here talking to you about FPU, which is the only other thing I ever get up here and talk to you guys about. Can you do me a favor, because I want to know who I'm talking to. Would you please raise your hand if you've ever gone through either Financial Peace University or the Legacy Journey class, either at St. Paul's or someplace else? All right. Nice smattering of hands. Thank you so much. If you've ever been through the class, I want to remind you that you can go through the class again for free as many times as you want to refresh yourself. What I'm here to talk to you about today is that we are offering another Financial Peace University class that starts next Sunday evening at 6:30. Stephanie and I will be teaching it. And I need your help. Those of you who've been through the class, evangelize it. Have somebody go through it. Right now, a lot of our families, a lot of people sitting in here are getting hit with the Christmas hangover. They had wonderful presents a couple weeks ago, and their credit card bills are starting to come in because of the wonderful Christmas that they provided their family. And some of them are going to be paying off Christmas until summertime, which is not fun. But if they can go through this class, if they can get control of their money, if you can get control of your money, then we can get you out of debt, and you can stay out of debt, and next Christmas will be a lot happier because it's not going to follow you through until summer vacation. So I would ask that the first class is free. You can stop in. You can have anybody stop in. They don't have to be members of the church. Stop in next Sunday at 6:30. Don't have to call. Don't have to write. Don't have to text or anything. Just show up here at the church at 6:30 next Sunday. We'll get you into the right classroom. Stephanie and I will run you through the class. If you enjoy the first class and you'd like to stick around, great. We'll take your $90 at that point and give you a kit and send you on your way and see you the next week. If you've been through the class and you know of somebody that needs to go through it, one powerful thing you can do is buy the class for them and send them through. A lot of times that happens with either discreetly. The church office is really good at doing that quietly so that you don't know that that people don't know that you're the benefactor. Or oftentimes people will do that and give you the stipulation to the people going through the class that I will pay for it, but you owe me the money back if you don't finish the class. And so it can be powerful, it can be life-changing. It was life-changing for my family. I have a passion for it. I haven't shared this story yet before. I watched my parents lose their house because they mismanaged money. I don't have a childhood home to go back to. I have a childhood apartment that I can go visit because of what they did after I moved out of the house. They didn't communicate about money. They thought they had everything under control. And were so out of control. In fact, they found out in the newspaper that they were losing their house. And I don't want that to ever happen to anybody else, and I'm certainly not letting that happen to myself or my family. I'm taking control of my money, and I hope that you can take control of your money too. We have a short video that Eric's gonna queue up for us, and thank you for listening.
Financial Peace University began about 20 years ago, and now today we've had over 1.5 million families go through this course. This is the place where we start happening to our money, where we start aiming our dollars at our goals. You got to make your money behave. You work too hard to get to the end of your life and be broke. There's a massive group of people out there trying to sell you stuff. They want to interrupt your plan. Don't cash out your 401k. I know your 401k looks like a 201k. Remain calm. The only people that get hurt on a roller coaster are those that jump off.
God's all in this thing. He's all about fixing you. He's all about fixing me. There's a redemption story built into this whole thing.
And every time I give, every time I understand I'm not an owner, I move along that spectrum from selfish to selfless. Now, this is a boot camp. I'm your coach. I've had some good coaches, and they lit me up a time or two, but it caused me to go places I couldn't go otherwise.
You change your life when you get sick and tired of being sick and tired, where you say, I've had it. This is how you get out of debt. You gotta run for your life. You gotta run, 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 run. You gotta bust it. You gotta go like your life depends on it.
What would happen to the kingdom of God if the people of God were out of debt?
This time we'll gather our offering. Thank you, Nate, for sharing. And again, the class is forming. We hope you could sponsor folks or if you'd like to be a part of that class.
Please stand. We pray together. Merciful God, receive the gifts we bring, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Through this meal, unite us as your body, shining with the light of your justice and mercy, for the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so, with all of the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, in whom you have revealed yourself, our light and our salvation. You sent a star to guide wise men to where the Christ was born, and your signs and witnesses in every age and through all the world have led your people from far places to his light. In his baptism and in table fellowship, he took his place with sinners. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, recovering sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Together, let us proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection, and we look with hope for his coming. Come, Lord Jesus. Holy God, we long for your Spirit. Come among us. Bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. Come, Holy Spirit. All praise and glory are yours, Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, Power of the Most High. one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Join together with one another as a family of faith as we pray in the words that our Savior taught. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us
Congregation, may be seated. We who are many are made one body as we all partake in this one bread. Come, be filled with light and life. All are welcome. Invite the congregation to stand as we prepare to go out and serve. May the body and the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in true faith unto life everlasting. We pray together. O morning star, fair and bright, you have refreshed us again with heavenly food. You are our dearest treasure. Go with us now, today, tomorrow, every day. We tell the story of your never-ending love. Sing your praise, both now and forever. Amen. May the God of glory dwell in you richly, name you beloved, and shine brightly on your path. And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
Peace. Be the light of Christ.